basically, we along with our entire team, we have a trump card in our hand who helps us to detect any intraoperative or during intra-intervention morbidity. So I call upon Dr. Nishanth to talk about role of neuro-physiology in making both these procedures very safe.
Expensive trump card. Very cheap. Okay. No. I'm talking about the trump card. No, because rare trump cards are, you know, very difficult to keep.
Right. So.
How expensive are you?
Not so expensive.
Cheaper than
so I'd like to start my talk with a message that whether the carotid artery stenosis is being managed by a neurovascular surgeon or an interventional neurologist or a vascular surgeon, neuromonitoring is mandatory. So these are the goals of my presentation. It is to review basic physiology of cerebral circulation, to discuss the iatrogenic complications of carotid artery interventions, and what are the intraoperative modalities that are of benefit for these procedures. And we've already, Sir has already answered the question to whether to go in for no shunting or routine shunting. The current consensus is selective shunting, and how to choose patients for shunting. So on which patients we'll do shunting, on which patients we do not do shunting. So neuromonitoring guides it, so I'll also talk about it. And then finally about the neuroprotective measures. So brain is about a 1.4 kilogram organ, and which has about 100 billion neurons. It constitutes only 2% of body weight. It accounts for about 15% of cardiac output to the brain. It accounts for about 20% of oxygen consumption, and the gray matter receives about 4 times more blood supply when compared to the white matter. Now, if brain were a pressure passive system, this is how the pressure flow relationship is going to look. But then there are mechanisms, especially pre-capillary arterioles, which can maintain flow constant over a wide range of pressure. So this is the graph that we are all aware of, the autoregulation graph. So between pressure of 50 to 150 millimeters of mercury, the blood flow is kept constant. And beyond these limits, the vessels are going to fail. So below mean arterial pressure of 50, the vessel cannot dilate more and then it will collapse. And beyond a pressure of about 150 millimeters of mercury, the vessel can no longer constrict, and then because of flow mediated hyperemia, there will be dilatation, which can produce hemorrhage. Now, what is the nature's way of protecting such a delicate organ to wide ranges of pressures and to its oxygen requirements? So we have major anastomosis, the circle of Willis. However, things will not be rosy like this always. There is plenty of anatomical variations of circle of Willis. Now, apart from these major vessels, yet another system which we are not sensitized to is the leptomeningeal system. So Vishwa was talking about alluding it to traffic. Traffic, you can see why, it's similar to a high traffic system. So however, these leptomeningeal anastomosis are highly variable across individuals. So we cannot rely on these anastomosis to successfully complete a carotid cross clamping. Now, this is an experimental evidence which shows these collateral circulation at work. So you can see these are the various vascular territories, ACM, CA, and PCA territories. And within 10 seconds of pressure drop in the middle cerebral artery, you can see that the ACA and PCA territories are, you know, going into the MCA territory. So that's the speed at which these anastomoses work. Now moving on to carotid endarterectomy. So this is what is happening. So you have a plaque that is obstructing the blood flow. So the main complication of these of this clinical entity is stroke. Now, what is ironical about this is that the interventions, the complication of the interventions of carotid endarterectomy is also stroke. So how to prevent that? So among the various complications, most often encountered is the ischemic and embolic stroke. And because patients are also likely to have coronary atherosclerosis, intra-myocardial infarction is also common. This is also contributed by the fact that you may have to, fiddle around with the blood pressures, which can also predispose the patient to myocardial infarction. And the post-operative period, carotid restenosis and brain hemorrhage can happen. So these are all the areas where neuromonitoring can help. And the incidence of stroke after intervention ranges between 2 to 10%. So it's imperative that we need to do something so as to avoid these complications. Another interesting thing is that among the various, we can do certain things to avoid a particular complication, but that very, preventive method can increase the risk of other complications. For example, if you want to avoid embolism, we have to carefully manipulate the vessel. But this increases the duration of surgery and the clamp time, which predisposes to ischemic stroke. If we want to avoid ischemia, we have to place a shunt. But the very act of placing the shunt can increase the risk of stroke by embolism. So, and the list goes on. So that's the kind of tricky situation that carotid endarterectomy is. So this illustrates, and the most critical step is carotid cross clamping. And what to do? Routine shunting or no shunting? What is the solution to this? So selective shunting is the present consensus, and this is because 85% of patients who undergo carotid cross clamping for about 30 minutes do not require shunt, and about 50% of patients with severe contralateral disease also don't need shunt for a clamping duration of about 30 minutes. So, and the support of collateral circulation, that also changes. There is a high inter-individual variability. So which patients require stenosis, shunting? That depends on the degree of stenosis, contralateral disease, extent of atherosclerosis, status of autoregulatory mechanisms, and status of collateral circulation. Of course, we cannot pre-op decide which individual is going to need a shunt, although there are certain markers. We need to have some evidence to guide our intraoperative decision. So for that, we need to assess cerebral blood flow intraoperatively. And among the various tests, there are a whole range of tests that has been described in literature. I'm not just restricting to electrophysiology. One could use transcranial Doppler also, or invasive metabolic measures also. But then they are not of use routinely. One could also use an awake procedure. One can perform a carotid endarterectomy and a local procedure. Among the electrophysiological methods, most commonly used are EEG, somatosensory evoked potential, and motor evoked potential. So what is the ideal technique? An ideal technique that assesses cerebral blood flow should instantaneously identify reduced perfusion, reliably represent an improvement in perfusion following restorative measures, does not meddle with the ongoing surgery, it should be easy to perform and affordable. And the answer to all these criteria is multimodal neuromonitoring incorporating multiple electrophysiological techniques. So this will once again justify why electrophysiology must be done. So this is from an experiment done in 1980s. So what this graph illustrates is cerebral blood flow on the y-axis and the duration of flow at a particular time to produce an ischemic injury. So you can see that 50 ml per 100 gram per minute is a normal value, and as it reduces to 22 ml, there won't be any change either functionally or electrophysiologically. So that's the reserve that we have. And below this functional threshold is the blood flow has to reach to very low levels to actually cause an insult to the neurons. So this is called the lesion threshold. Now the lesion threshold depends on the duration for which the ischemia persists. So if the blood flow is about 18 ml, it has to be sustained for about, you know, more than 2 hours to produce a lesion. However, if the blood flow is in the range of 5 to 10 ml per 100 gram per minute, even short durations can produce lesion. And this is the region of penumbra, the adjacent regions which are at risk but directly not but themselves not already damaged. So the whole goal is, so you can see that electrophysiological disturbance start manifesting prior to the lesion threshold. So if you use electrophysiology, it can, you know, predict or it can serve as a warning criteria so that some restorative measures could be taken so as to avoid a permanent neurological deficit. So multimodal neuromonitoring using EEG, SSEP and MEP is the standard of care. So EEG represents the summated excitatory and inhibitory postsynaptic potentials. So it reflects the activity of the cortex alone. It has a high temporal resolution but a very poor spatial resolution. What it means is that, you know, there could be, it is not a foolproof technique because each electrode picks up activity from millions of neurons. So there could be, you need to have damage across wide range of neurons for it to be manifest in the EEG. And only cortex is being sampled using this particular technique. So this is an example in our case, one of our cases. So you can see good amplitude EEG waveforms here across these channels. And after about 2.5 minutes of cross clamping, you can see that the amplitudes have diminished. And after seeing this, we did countermeasure of raising the BP, and you can see that EEG has come back to baseline. So this was one of the examples where EEG proved useful for carotid cross clamping. Moving on, EEG reflects only the activity of the cortex. However, whole range of neurons at different depths could be at risk. So we need to use more techniques to sample more regions in the neuroaxis. So in SSEP, what we do is we stimulate a peripheral nerve and record from the cortex. So that way we can assess the entire sensory pathway. So we know the status of the brainstem, the lemniscal system and the cortical radiations. So this is one example where SSEPs are shown to be useful. You can see that it's not showing up. So the first so you can see that this is the SSEP and this is the corresponding EEG. So the cortical SSEPs are what that matter. So within about 2 minutes after clamping, you can see that there is a more than 50% reduction in the amplitude of SSEP. There is also concomitant EEG change, but it's not as dramatic as the SSEP change. And following this, a shunt was placed, and within a minute of placing a shunt, you can see that SSEPs have come back to baseline levels. So this another example. And however, SSEPs cannot, you know, address the issue of pure motor stroke because they assess only the sensory system. So in MEPs, what we do is we stimulate the cortex across the scalp and then record from the muscles. The disadvantage is that with every stimulation, the patient will, you know, go into a twitch, and that can produce movement which will disturb the surgeon. And this also requires the anesthetist not to relax the patient and to avoid inhalational agents. So this is an example where SSEPs are normal throughout the procedure. However, addition of MEP has picked up an ongoing motor stroke. You can see that SSEPs are intact at the same time. However, motors are getting, have got diminished. So, so one technique is not enough. We need to do multimodal neuromonitoring to pick up intraoperative strokes in these patients. So, so I've shown a few examples where with some intervention, you know, the neurophysiological changes are getting reversed. If they are not getting reversed, what to do? That means there is a stroke and we are not able to manage it. So, as in, we are not able to do so that do anything so that, you know, we are reversing the underlying cause. So in those cases, what we have to do is we have to initiate neuroprotective measures. So when there is ischemia, there is an imbalance, there is a mismatch between demand and supply. So what we do via neuroprotection is that we decrease the demand. So one of the ways is to push the brain into burst suppression using high dose of propofol or thiopentone, or to push the body into hypothermia. So this reduces the oxygen consumption of the neurons, making them sustain the ischemia for a longer duration of time. And this is how EEG looks during burst suppression. And one last point that I would like to say is the utility of recurrent laryngeal nerve monitoring. Dr. Rupesh mentioned the possibility of dysphagia because of damage to the recurrent laryngeal nerve in operating near the neck. So we could also look for it by placing an electrode close to the vocal cords. So for this, we use a special electrode called EMG endotracheal tube. So this is essentially a normal endotracheal tube around which there is a pickup electrode. So if the anesthetist places the tube in such a way that the pickup electrode is in contact with the vocal cords, then we get to know whenever the recurrent laryngeal nerve is getting irritated, then there will be some kind of a myogenic response from the muscle, which we can tell the surgeon. So this is our recent publication. We communicated our case series, our experience over the last 3 years. We have done about 15 patients under complete neuromonitoring cover, and we managed to publish this in Journal of Cerebrovascular Sciences, which is the official journal of Cerebrovascular Society of India. So let me recap the goals. We have reviewed the basics of basic physiology of cerebral circulation, discussed the iatrogenic complications. We also discussed what modalities are of use and how these modalities can guide in selective shunting, and how they can also guide in initiating neuroprotective measures. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Nishanth.